a very great pleasure to introduce today's speaker, who is a philosopher. He is a colleague of mine. He's also an old friend of mine, and his name is John Berto, as you know from the flyer. And let me tell you a couple of things about Professor Berto, because this is, if you think that the road to philosophy is, well, first you take classes, and then you get a degree, and then you teach, then that's one way of doing it, but there's also other ways of doing it. And John Berto, he didn't start in life as Marine, but at some point in time he became a Marine, which brought him to San Diego, which brought him to San Diego State, which brought him to UCSD. And then he left the academic system and worked for IBM, and then he had his own business. And according to, which I'm sure will be part of his legend, he went bankrupt, and that brought him back to school, where I met him as a part-time colleague over at San Diego State. Then getting a tenured job at Cal State University in Monterey Bay. And up until recently, he was a columnist at the Monterey Herald, a column called Connections, and he did that for 3 years. And the column was primarily on diversity issues, and some of those pieces have been republished and reproduced in a variety of journals. And I got to tell you that I'm very proud to have two of those pieces in the latest version of my textbook, The Moral Restorer. So happy about that. John Berto is not a stranger to this campus, aside from having once been a San Diegan. He was also here giving a talk approximately 10 years ago, and I was not chairing the series then, but I was certainly here. And what he talked about then was a topic called Kennedy Races Without Racism, which I think of as the, shall we say, the first phase in the research that has brought him to the paper that we're going to hear today, which is, the title is Whither Now, Individualism, Multiculturalism, or Assimilationism? And this paper, by the way, he will be giving at Ohio State next week. So this is a paper with staying power. Right now he's working on a paper called The Social Basis of Disrespect in relationship to John Rawls' theories of political philosophy, and he's working with Jerry Dockold over at UCSD, who's a famous contemporary philosopher. So it gives me great pleasure to introduce John Berto.
Speaking of Jerry Dockold, Jerry was my dissertation advisor, and Jerry said, remember that in any field, an expert is a guy who knows the same things that you know, it's just that he came from out of town to say them. So I'm from out of town, but I probably know the same thing you guys know. I should also say this, there's a little part of the introduction that Professor Rosenzahn left out, which is that I made the decision to go back to philosophy because of something that happened on this campus. I was getting a pilot's license. I don't know if they still have those courses here, but this is a long time ago, and I was taking those courses on this campus. And I was walking across the campus, and right off here, it was one of these benches, so it was right in this area, I ran into a guy who was teaching here part-time. He and I had worked at IBM together, and he said, you know, you went to UCSD and worked on a PhD for a while, and you should be doing this. You should be teaching part-time. I think you'd enjoy it. And it just kind of stuck back there. I went home, I thought about it, and I said, I should be. And a couple of months later, I drove up to UCSD and said, I want to get back in the PhD program that I was in 19 years ago. And they said, fine. This paper is, there's a genesis to it. Some of it, if somebody was here 10 years ago, and Dwight was, you were here, there are some paragraphs that are sort of the same. You'll hear them come up. But the basic argument has changed within the context of the culture, in the context of the paper. And I think that we often forget that these ideas develop over long periods of time. You throw something away, and then you come back to it. And what brought me back to this paper, after years, I mean, this thing literally is gone, was Barack Obama's election. And I started to think about the issues again, and then looked up the paper and started to rehash it within the context of these issues, and then wrote it, and you're seeing the product of it. The only difference between the way it was introduced is that it's individualism, multiculturalism, assimilationism, or cosmopolitanism. So one addition there. Three strands that you will see that I'm trying to weave in terms of this paper, which may be too much, and which may be the problem that I'm trying to do too much with the paper. The first is that in talking about issues of race and racism, I want to look at them as a global issue, not as a local issue. So what you'll see is that I use a lot of examples, global examples, rather than local examples. Secondarily, as I said, I'm concerned with Obama's election and what that means for these sorts of issues that I'm going to talk about. And then third, and this is probably the most important thing, I'm suspicious of isms that claim to contain the reality of race and racism. In other words, I don't think that we get an accurate conception of society from liberal conceptions of race and racism. This is what I'm arguing here. Whether or not individualism, multiculturalism, assimilationism, or cosmopolitanism, a matter of deep controversy in liberal democracies like Canada, Brazil, Britain, Australia, and the United States is how they should interpret racial identity and accommodate the existence of racial groups. Although the racialization of individuals has been coterminous with a saga of ruthless racial oppression, often the constituents of disadvantaged racial groups see their racial identity as something precious that should be valued and preserved. For many, the opportunity to identify with others in terms of a common racial heritage is a source of pride. Nevertheless, promoting racial identity, for example, through multiculturalism contradicts the traditional liberal individualist model of civil society. This disparity suggests that a central question is, what role, if any, is there for racial identity or racial consciousness in liberal democracies? Do we have to get rid of races to overcome racism? Or can philosophical liberalism be reinterpreted to accommodate racial identity? In this paper, I argue that the existence of racial groups poses special problems for the liberal tradition and the way liberal ideals are interpreted. My strategy is to explore examples suggesting that philosophical theories, isms, devised to reconcile liberal democracies to race and racism, fail to draw on a comprehensive or accurate picture of the social environment, leaving vital issues unaddressed. For example, the election of Barack Obama as President of the United States has led to a discussion about whether the U.S. has become a post-racial society. In a recent lecture, drawing heavily from a forthcoming article in the Du Bois Review, and the title of the article is Just Do It, Notes on Politics and Race at the Dawn of the Obama Presidency, sociologist Howard Winnett suggests that Obama's election offers no challenge to the structural racism reflected, for instance, in racial disparities in healthcare or African American and Latino economic inequality. In other words, Winnett insists it is not enough to focus on the attitudes of whites. Social evidence about the way the structure of society impacts non-whites is also important. Granted, Obama's election may not have resulted in a post-racial society, but when it observes Obama models a way to inhabit racial identity more consciously. While it is true that Obama's election may require us to redescribe race and racism, what is more important is that it does not necessarily follow that a redescription will take the culture any closer to an accurate representation of that reality. So, what special problems then does the existence of racial groups pose? For the classic liberal individualist, the prospect that liberal democratic nations would address racial exploitation and subordination through the distribution or the redistribution of resources to racial groups is heresy. For example, philosopher Chandran Kakathis insists that liberal democracies need not abandon their individualist language to accommodate cultural communities. It isn't only that attributing irreducible moral claims to minority cultures challenges the individualist foundation of the liberal tradition, but the liberal tradition's individualist philosophy is key to overcoming problems that are associated with the existence and interaction of cultural minorities. Since cultural communities, racial communities, are in essence composed of individuals, and liberal theory is individualist, Kakathis claims that if you recognize the individual, you recognize the group. The cultural community has a value, but not apart from its benefit to the individual. In the case of racial oppression, society can legitimate the claims of groups that have been injured and compensate individuals for their injuries without attributing irreducible moral claims or moral claims to group rights to racial communities. Thus, institutional mechanisms are all that is necessary to resolve the claims of oppressed racial groups. Hence, the individualist model reconstitutes all harm as individual harm. Racial hate crimes, for instance, would have no more than a statistical significance. Although an individual has been injured and should be in some way compensated, that compensation should not acknowledge racial identity. The individualist model treats a person as somehow alienated, disunited, or severed from all worldly attributes as an abstract individual. By focusing on the abstract individual, the model overlooks the deeper social and psychological significance of hate crimes. As a result, it does not accept that a person harmed as a member of a despised group can suffer on account of a shared negative identity. While a racialized individual may be harmed as an individual, in relation to the common political community, it is important to note that she is vulnerable precisely because she is a member of a racialized minority. She suffers irrespective of her personal traits, motivations, or achievements. She suffers irrespective of these things. That vulnerability enters her identity and it shapes it. Indeed, historian George Lipsitz offers an analysis of race that acknowledges the importance of psychological, structural, and relational factors in the formation of racial identity and racism. He argues that through various discriminatory government policies in awarding home mortgages and public housing and education, all these things in the 1930s, whites as a group develop economic advantages in the United States. Because these advantages, artfully insinuated themselves into white identity, white came to mean the right to economic advantage. Economic advantage created an investment on the part of whites in whiteness, and a sense of non-whites as not just subjects of economic disadvantage, but as groups that one expects, without ever thinking about it, to be economically worse off and deserving of their poverty. Given that Lipsitz is correct, racial identity and racism is less a matter of white supremacy or of snarling contempt than it is the product of white's unconscious, innocent, or unknowing expectation of advantage. After all, in a dog-eat-dog world where people are battling each other for a job or for certain rewards, if you tend to get certain rewards as a rule, once you have them, and you've had them for a while, you think you can buy them naturally. Of course, the flip side of this is true for the disadvantaged. To take a case in point, associating blackness with the expectation of disadvantage, exclusion, or marginalization, blacks may demand less from the state and therefore get less. So racial injustice not only enters the identity of the individual to define the relationship between racial groups, it also defines the relationship of blacks, for example, to their own blackness. Hence, racial advantage or disadvantage insinuates itself into the identity of the individual. I'm reminded here of an example that I don't use here. I have a more global example, which I'm going to use in just a second, which is the French. But I want to use this other example because it's the one that's in your text. Okay, and it's about violence against women, actually. And I was thinking about it when I wrote that article that, that Professor Rosenstein has in her text. And here's the example. We know it, and I'm not going to go into this. We know that throughout campuses all over the United States, there's concern. There are evening classes women won't attend because of violence, because of rape, and those kinds of things that go on the campus. And now, of course, this wasn't true when I was a student at San Diego State 40 years ago, or whatever it was. We didn't have buses to take people to various classes and all of that. You walked wherever you went. Well, what happened is I was talking about violence against women in the class one day and about how that difference can enter the identity of women to shape them in the same way that we talk about racial difference entering the identity of people to shape them. And I went on and on and on. And after the class was over, I was at Palomar College. I was teaching at Palomar. And so they have a parking lot that's way out in the middle of nowhere over at Palomar. And I was walking from my class to my office, and a young man walked up behind me. And he said, Professor Bertone, you know, I was thinking about what you said. It's really interesting about the gender thing. He said, about 3 or 4 weeks ago, I have a night class on campus, and I was leaving the class to go home. And as I was walking to my class, there was a young lady who was kind of behind me walking along. And it bothered me. I kept looking over my shoulder. And after a little while, she kind of caught up just as we were getting to that parking lot. You know the one way over there. I said, oh, yeah, I know that. He said, yeah. So we walked along, and she got to her car. I got to my car, and we left. But we had a nice chat. So about 2 weeks later, or a week later, I was at a party, and she was there. And so I tried to talk to her. And I was surprised that she wouldn't talk to me. You see, when we were walking together to the lot, I thought she was trying to pick me up. I never thought that she might be scared. And that's why she was walking to the lot with me in the middle of the night, which is just how this difference enters your identity to shape you. Can't see it, can't taste it, it's just there. So now back to the modern day example. I remember that. Modern day France offers an excellent example of this individualist thesis. The French refuse to distinguish between racial, ethnic, and national identities. There are no French Algerians, French Moroccans, or Afro-French. Liberal democratic France promotes individual rights and liberties, although they maintain that they've established a colorblind society. Young Arab and African men sparked riots that spread across the country. This was in October of 2005. They're pleased, this is one of the suburbs outside of Paris. Their pleas for education and decent housing echoed the cries historically raised by oppressed minorities. In 2008, Stephen Erlanger reported that the riots continue sporadically, and France's president, Nicolas Sarkozy, who was interior minister 3 years ago and called the rioters rabble and scum, has put three women from immigrant backgrounds into his government. The idea, according to Erlanger, is to have immigrants who understand immigrants promote economic, political, social, and psychological assistance for the poor and working class minorities living in France's ghettos. In addition, France is testing affirmative action programs in its elite universities. My conclusion then is that the riots and continuing unrest moves Sarkozy to see the need for a synthesis of social and psychological insights about race and racism. If Lipsitz and others are correct, individualists do not conceive the full significance of racial identity. Dealing with the consequences of racial injustice and inequality may require more than redistributing the economic benefits and burdens of society to individuals. Specifically, it could entail changing individuals at the deepest level, the level of their identity. Okay, that's individualism. What special problems does race and racism raise for or pose for multiculturalism? Let's take the second leg of this now. Using the French again. Conversely, the French are the subordinate culture in Canada. Canada, however, a multiracial, multi-ethnic society, has an official policy of multiculturalism. Its social pluralism led to a 1963 Royal Commission on Biculturalism and Bilingualism that made both English and French official languages. As a result, because Quebecers are concerned with the survival of their French culture, there are language laws that regulate who can send their children to English language schools. According to these laws, Francophones and immigrants must send their children to French schools, while Canadian Anglophones can send their children to English language schools. For multiculturalists like philosopher Will Kimlicka, the world's history of colonialism, race slavery, and racial oppression has produced a complicated and nettlesome situation that challenges the notion that it is possible to build societies free of racial animus by drawing solely upon impartial, liberal, individualist ideals. Kimlicka complicates the individualist paradigm by emphasizing that who I am is related to how I'm recognized. Cultural membership anchors self-identity. Self-identity and self-esteem are, at least in part, social products. While members of liberal democratic societies are individuals, their racial or ethnic membership may affect how they are identified, irrespective of their ambitions, desires, motivations, or achievements. And that is the reason it is necessary to recognize race or ethnic identity in a positive rather than negative way. Hence, Kimlicka reinterprets the liberal individualist thesis so as to designate ethnic, national, or immigrant identity as the basis of moral claims and political demands. He holds that liberal democracy should give equal moral weight to the interests and claims made in the name of disadvantaged minorities, because that would result in equal recognition, and equal recognition is inextricably bound up with respect. Cultural membership shapes identity and affects self-determination. Cultural identities provide individuals with meaningful options. Cultural identities are the basis of freedom and dignity. In short, the existence of a cultural community as a context of choice is of primary importance for the liberal tradition. Nonetheless, a variety of arguments can be advanced to challenge existing racial and cultural identities as a sound normative basis for public recognition, public policy, and group rights. For instance, sociologists Michael Ami and Howard Winnett regard race as a dynamic set of social meanings and realities. They argue that these are historically contested identities that are created, transformed, and recreated over time. They insist that the history of African Americans should be seen as a contest over what it means to be black in America. The identities of African Americans, or Africans in America, was formed and transformed over more than two centuries of slavery, racism, civil war, reconstruction, civil rights, black power, affirmative action, and now the election of Barack Obama. The existence of intra and intergroup conflicts about race and racism reveals the problems that attempts to preserve racial identity. Racial identities are not only complex and volatile, as these guys suggest, but they're also mutually constituted or dialogical. They are the products of contestations that reflect the structure of power in society. For instance, in January of 2009, Norimitsu Onishi reported that Japan's crowning of Hiromu Nonaka as its top leader would have been as significant as America's election of its first black president. Mr. Nonaka is a descendant of a racialized minority, the Boraku. In Japan, there are approximately 2.5 million Borakumen. Although the Borakumen have no physical differences from the Japanese population, they are referred to as Japan's invisible race. Historically, the Borakumen were racialized because of the type of work they did, dealing with the remains of dead animals. Presently, they do not work in these traditional occupations. And this is Mr. Nonaka. Here he is in the Congress. Therefore, Borakumen identity is not solely a product of the respective communities. Rather, it results from a history of interaction between the dominant Japanese community in Japan and a racialized minority. Now, I draw on this example because the racial identity imposed on the Borakumen has been confining, oppressive, and based on ideological distortions of their nature. So although the Japanese began affirmative action policies for the Boraku some years ago, many of them have fought legislation, registries, and ordinances that, while helpful in fighting discrimination, might also identify them as Boraku. In short, racial identity, since they reflect inequalities of power, can embody inequalities of dignity and self-esteem. Hence, to attain respect, many Borakumen have found it reasonable and necessary to reject their imposed racial identity and to develop another sense of themselves. I gotta tell this little story. My daughter-in-law, my son lives in Tokyo. My daughter-in-law and my son visited a number of years ago, and we were talking, and this is during the transition phase of this paper, and so I had been reading about the Boraku. And I asked her about that. Her name's Yoshiko, and she's Japanese, and had lived her whole life in Tokyo. And so I asked her about the Boraku, and she said, no, we don't have that in Japan. There's nothing like that in Japan. So Davey and she lived here for a number of years, and then he went back to Japan. I never pushed it, you know. So they went back to Japan, and he's one of those international bankers that we all hate now. That's yeah. And I hate him too. hate to, because I'm still trying to pay off those college loans. Anyway, they went back to Japan, and what happened is, after they were there a couple of years, she called me one weekend. We didn't talk a lot, but she called. She was in tears on the phone, and she was apologizing, saying how sorry she was. And I finally made out what had happened. What had happened was that a friend of hers had visited her, and the friend had gotten married and had been married for about 6 months and had found out she had married a buraku after she had married the guy. And the parents found out. Now, the way the parents found out was that the buraku men are segregated in Tokyo. Can't see what they look like or how different they are, but they only live in certain areas of the city. So the parents found out where the boy's parents were from. And once they found that out, they knew he had to be buraku. And they forced her to divorce him. And she was upset, needless to say, because she had, you know, said, no, you don't know what you're talking about. And obviously she didn't know what she was talking about. But it's how hidden it is in the culture. They don't talk about it a lot. It exists. Okay, the point is that although multiculturalists seek to acknowledge and accommodate group identity and difference, where people identify themselves and others as belonging to different races, there may be violations of liberal ideals, resulting in inequality, subordination, and racism. Consequently, acknowledging and accommodating racial identity may not rescue the liberal tradition. Which ideal, then, should liberal democracies embrace? Given that established racial identity is not necessarily a sound basis for recognition and respect, it is possible that a liberal democracy should reject any desire of its members to identify in terms of a common racial consciousness. I turn to this key issue. What problems or what special problems does the existence of racial groups pose for assimilationism? According to philosopher Richard Wasserstrom, in creating and tolerating a society in which race matters, we must recognize that we have created a vastly more complex concept of race, which includes what might be called ethnicity, as well as a set of attitudes, beliefs, traditions, etc., which the society has made part of what it means to be a race. Focusing on this complexity raises crucial questions for liberal social theorists. Generally, they concede that racial identity or consciousness is important, and that liberal democracies can, in certain ways, acknowledge and accommodate race. And yet, my criticisms of Kukathis and Kimlicka insist that they leave a number of issues concerning racial identity unattended. Do we get an accurate picture of society from the liberal conceptions of race? Do the issues that Kukathis and Kimlicka leave unattended imply that there may be no role for race in a liberal democracy? Wasserstrom defines three rival ideals of a non-racist society: assimilation, diversity, and tolerance. He also claims that there are three realms in which racism affects society. The first is the political realm of equal political and civil rights. The second is the realm of equal education and equal employment and promotion. And the third is the realm of personal relationships, for example, love, sex, marriage, and private association. The critical question is, which ideal, assimilation, diversity, tolerance, which of these three is best for all three realms in which racism affects society? In the realm of political and civil rights, the three ideals agree that race should not matter. In the realm of education and employment opportunity, they also agree that race should not matter. A non-racist society is clearly a society in which there is no racial discrimination at the level of major political and economic institution. All the ideals agree on this. Thus, this leaves the third realm, of personal relationships as the primary site of controversy between the rival liberal ideals. What would be the effect in the third realm of adopting each of these ideals? Which ideal should a liberal democracy or a liberal society embrace? Rochester outlines at least three problems with anti-assimilationist ideals, diversity and tolerance. First, anti-assimilationist ideals would sustain unequal relationships of power. Given that historically the recognition of difference has led to the concentration of power in the hands of whites, then it seems that in a non-racist society, or that a non-racist society would not promote ideals that acknowledge or accommodate difference. Second, anti-assimilationist ideals may not provide the space required for individuality, authenticity, or freedom. For instance, if one understands what it means for a woman to be identified as not feminine enough, or for a man to be identified as not masculine enough, then it is clear the way feminine or masculine identities can be confining to one's identity. The roles associated, Wasserstrom suggests that race works in the same way as feminine and masculine identities. The roles associated with racial identity or consciousness necessarily imposes limits, restrictions on what one can do, be, or become. To take a case in point, President Obama observed that at various stages in the primary campaign, some commentators deemed me either too black or not black enough. I took him to mean that if he appeared too black, he would alienate white voters. Conversely, if he appeared not black enough, he might push away black voters. As a result, he is imprisoned by a role. Third, then, since all role-differentiated living is restrictive, Wasserstrom insists that perhaps all strongly role-differentiated societies are objectionable. Consequently, he says, as such, I think they, meaning the anti-assimilationist ideals, are prima facie wrong. In sum, then, Wasserstrom contends that under the assimilationist ideal, racial groups would be absorbed into the majority community. The community as a whole would acknowledge and emphasize a common identity, common memories, traditions, beliefs, ways of feeling, thinking, and so on. Black identity, for example, would be converted into something indistinguishable from white identity, and that suggests that race would disappear. Now, before the example that I have here, the reason that I use this image is that often people, when I say that race would disappear, the argument is that, well, you would end up with the other image. If you remember the image in the beginning with a bowler hat, and there's nothing there, you end up with that kind of an image, this abstract identity. But if you think about how assimilationism has actually worked, let's take for example, Latinos, are people in Latin America, the Aboriginal people there, assimilated to the Catholic religion. And what came out the other end? Well, it was called Catholicism. In many instances, didn't look anything like the Catholicism that was brought into the country. We can say the same thing about Christianity in this country. Blacks assimilated to Christianity, but the Christianity that came out on the other side, while it was similar, it was still different. So assimilation is not this kind of abstract thing, is the point of using this. Okay, so the example, Argentina is the case. In Argentina, all the blacks have disappeared. In 2005, a Washington Post article touts this as one of Argentina's most enduring mysteries. Early in the 19th century, blacks composed close to 30% of the population of Argentina's capital, Buenos Aires, the capital city, Buenos Aires. While near the end of that century, their numbers had decreased precipitously. Where did all the blacks go? The article asks. Recent studies suggest that black Argentines did not vanish they just faded into the mixed-race population. According to Professor Miriam Gomes, an Afro-Argentine teaching at the University of Buenos Aires, many black Argentines simply deny they're black. They want to believe they're white, she says. Here, if someone has one drop of white blood, they call themselves white. Likewise, Wasserstrom holds that under the assimilationist ideal, a non-racist society would be one in which the race of an individual would be the functional equivalent of eye color of individuals in our society. In our society, no basic political rights, obligations, important institutional benefits and burdens are connected to eye color. Follows then, only when races have disappeared, only when skin color ceases to have any meaning in all three realms, will we evolve into a genuinely ideal non-racist society. Of course, this leaves open one key question. Is racial identity or consciousness that is voluntarily chosen and not associated with exploitation, subordination, and oppression really racial identity, or is it something else? What special problems does the existence of racial groups pose for cosmopolitanism? Philosopher Jeremy Waldron offers a cosmopolitan description of the modern liberal democratic state. Due to increased communication, the networking of economies, and the intensification of worldwide social relations, cultures have been delocalized. The one person, one culture model no longer best describes the modern state. Presently, liberal democracies are best portrayed as a cultural mirage, societies made up of individuals whose personal identities are a product of a plurality of identities. Waldron characterizes this as the one person, many fragments model of identity. According to Waldron, the fragments model resolves many of the issues associated with taking racial identity or cultural identity as fundamental to personal identity. For example, the one person, one culture model of identity presupposes an essentialist notion of group identity. It compartmentalizes and universalizes group identity, and that results in a simplistic vision cultural identity or racial identity. Besides, Waldron claims, where personal identity is the product of many cultures, it isn't just that there are many cultural identities to draw on, but one culture should have no more value or be no more valuable than another. Given the many fragments model of personal identity, the demise of one culture that is part of the common political community should not, as Kimlicka suggests, lead to irreparable harm, since the individual could draw on other identities. Indeed, philosopher Anthony Appiah challenges the work of well-meaning intellectuals who have exaggerated the significance of foreignness. He insists that today there is no expectation that everyone should be the same or have the same values, only that all human beliefs and values should carry equal moral weight and should be shared. Hence, Appiah says, cosmopolitanism is, and I quote, a connection not through identity, but despite difference. Waldron and Appiah defend a cosmopolitan alternative to the view that racial or cultural identity is something precious that should be preserved. Yet, many insist that there are local, racial, ethnic, or cultural identities that are more important than global identities. There are commitments that we have to family and friends that supersede those we might have to distant others. Philosopher Richard Rorty, for example, argues that our loyalty to distant others will weaken and even vanish when things get tough. He asks us to imagine what would happen if we were asked to help a family member pursued by the police. Although torn by loyalty and justice, many of us would help, even though we were aware that the individual had committed a crime. There would be conflict, but the conflict would exist only to the extent that we could identify with the innocent person who was harmed by our relative's action. If The individual harmed was of a different race, class, or nation, the conflict would be weaker. So too, between Mexican Americans that might survive, there might survive special moral duties that might not exist between Mexican Americans and people across the globe. Here I'm reminded of the recent killing of the three policemen in Oakland. After that happened, there was an article in the newspaper in which the newspaper interviewed an old black woman who was in the neighborhood. And she said, and paraphrasing now, she said, boy, you know, that was really sad. That was really something. She said, the reason it was sad was because everybody knew where that guy was hiding. Nobody told the police. They all knew he was in so-and-so's house. I don't remember, cousin's house or whatever. Said that nobody would talk to the police and let them know, and these guys walked in and they all get shot. Three policemen, I think. Four get shot. So same kind of issue, these connections which cross lines that cosmopolitanism does not take into account. So final critique of cosmopolitanism. In addition, how does one square cosmopolitanism's connection despite difference with the violence and conflict associated with race and racism? While it is possible to model identity in terms of fragments, it isn't clear what that means in real life. For example, sociologist Stephen Cornell and Douglas Hartman says that race has power and force because it has been a foundational feature of American life. They hold that it is an identity constructed by others. Race is an identity that is based on perceived physical differences, differences that reflect power relations, that imply inherent differences of worth. What makes race real is a matter of possessing the power to construct a category that includes some and excludes others. Cornell and Hartman argue that exploitation, subordination, and oppression are experiences that historically have been a part of the social environment that racial groups inhabit. As a result, it appears that wherever people see themselves as belonging to racial groups, there have always been violations of liberal ideals. In short, the issue is not whether we can connect despite difference, but rather, can there be races without racism? What does this analysis recommend? My analysis challenges the notion that these isms can easily seat the social reality and normative claims of racial groups. It promotes the importance of reflecting on the socio-historical processes by which racial categories are created, inhabited, and transformed over time. It suggests that if the United States is to become a post-racial society, what is needed is a deeper, more inclusive, fine-grained, sensitive understanding of race and racism. In 1997, to promote dialogue about the country's race problem, President Bill Clinton made an effort to start a national conversation about race by appointing an advisory board. In 2008, presidential candidate Barack Obama urged citizens to move beyond treating race as only a spectacle. He encouraged us to address racial problems without anger, shame, guilt, or defensiveness. And a few weeks ago, the first African-American Attorney General, Eric Holder, in a speech before Justice Department employees, called citizens of the United States a nation of cowards because we do not talk about race. This is important because it reminds us that race and racism can be redescribed in better ways, making it a more effective tool for social critique and social change. The possibility of the erasure or exclusion of the lived experience of others from our worldview requires that we take a critical stance towards those who justify philosophical theory by arguing simply that it promotes equality and justice. We must sensitize ourselves and others to anguish and humiliation that goes unnoticed. As Susan Zoff intends, theoretical debate does harm if preoccupation with it distracts attention from the social evils from which it sprang, where one's own identity can be shaped without any relationship, reciprocity, or mutual respect for those defined as other, what is valuable becomes deeply and profoundly biased in the direction of one's own identity. Thank you. Racialization to mean the social construction. This is from Martin, and this is his quote: "The way race is produced and bestowed on people by institutional social action, and not simply as a condition found in people as a racial category. So racialization means that race is something people do rather than what they are." And so this isn't. That agrees exactly with what you're saying. The other thing is that there's another note in here. Miriam Goins actually says that, yeah, they declare that they're white, and they see themselves that way, and if you go and ask them, they'll say, no, I'm white. The issue is that that hasn't gotten rid of discrimination and inequality. It still exists in the society, even though people declare themselves to be one thing rather than which is kind of interesting too, because it, I think that ties into that psychological stuff.
What about race and class? My understanding, if you go back to early American colonial times, and I get this from, for example, reading Howard Zinn, but it was a problem in that the people at the bottom of the socioeconomic scale, whether they were white or black, would associate together and would basically see themselves as common group of people. So it became necessary to divide them by putting in place strict laws, classifying people by race and forbidding mixture and so forth.
Yeah.
It had to be created because originally you didn't really have that sense of racial distinctiveness. You have more sense of class. Comment on that?
Yeah, I stutter because there's so many ways to go. First of all, let me say this.
Okay.
The class issue is always problematic because what we know is that there's a sense in which race tracks class.
Mm-hmm.
So you could have a large number of poor people people at the bottom of the socioeconomic ladder, and what you notice is that as a percentage of a certain group, it's usually a non-white group that fills that void, or that's the vast majority that's there. So that's the issue. What I was thinking about as you were talking about that. The other thing I was thinking about is a book by Noel Ignatia called How the Irish Became White.
Right.
Yeah, many in this society forget that the Irish, well, to
to put it simply, the Irish were called white niggers, or niggers turned inside out, and they lived with blacks, and that's, and, but what happened is, and this is the difference between race and ethnicity and the class issue. Let me say, let me put in one little addendum, and then I'll get to the difference. In Brazil, they talk about whitening, and what they say is that money can whiten, okay? So think about the Irish and what happened there and how they moved out of, how they became white. The argument is that ethnic groups, once you can do that, once you can start to declare yourself as a member of a certain group, it's no longer a race. Okay, that's a whole different thing going on. Race is something that works differently. It is somebody telling you where you belong rather than you're saying, you know, that you're a part of a certain group. This same thing, Ignatieff's book is taken from another book, and I can't remember the woman's name, but the story there is how the Jews became white. Okay, so you get this kind of, and as there is this movement from race to class, or this class movement from race to ethnicity, or, wait a minute, let me restate that. As there is this movement from race to ethnicity, there is a class movement along with it. That's what I was trying to say. Okay. So by the 30s, what do you have? You know, you go to, I don't know, New York, or I don't know this, I watched The Godfather. You get the Irish firemen, and they're the ones, you know, and how do they get the job? Well, it's because my grandmother's cousin had the job, and my uncle had it, and so my son comes up and he gets it and all of that. So there's this ethnic thing, but it's a class thing too. And they track the parallel picture. That answers.
It provides a lot of insight on the relationship between rising and class. Yeah. Changes your way you perceive.
Yeah. And notice, even in, look, we think about that. I was thinking about this the other day. You know, one of the positive things about affirmative action is that since it started, it's produced a black middle class. Okay? And that has complicated the notion of what it means to be black. So can you be black? Is he black enough? Is he really black? How black is he? And all of that becomes a matter of money can whiten, you know, the picture of LeBron James. That picture has a whole, even though part of the issue with showing that was the ideas that it evokes. It has a whole different meaning than what's here. But you wonder when the guys made this picture what they were thinking about. Because so these racial identities play in a lot of different ways. The piece that you were talking about, here's what happened. This was my trying to understand this sort of thing, but it was about gender, and it was how gender enters your identity to shape you in ways in which you're not aware. That was the, I was trying to think about that. And I found myself doing, and I wrote the piece about myself, about what I found myself doing, which was walking across campus and seeing the young lady and saying, what's your name?
Angela.
And I'd say, Angela, did you have your hand up in class today and I didn't call on you? And usually they would say, no, or, yeah, I did, but it doesn't matter, it's not a big deal. And so, but I was sensitive to that for a very specific reason. And this happened in San Diego State. We were talking about gender issues one day. And we'd spent a number of while in the class talking about it, we were near the end of the class, and I said, okay, let me say a few things, and then I'll get you out of here, okay? And I started to say a few things, and there was a young lady sitting right in front. Her name is Danusha. Danusha raised her hand. And I said, oh, hang on a minute, Danusha, hang on a second, and I'll get right to you. And then I finished what I'm going to say, and when I finished what I was going to say, I called on the guy right behind her. It was no more than a second later. Now, what had happened, our discussion was about, and these young ladies in the class were saying, well, if I raise my hand three times in a professor's class and he doesn't call on me, that's it, I'm not raising it again for the semester. And I was standing there listening, going, whoa, geez, that's heavy. Never happened in my class. And that was the discussion. And it wasn't just an issue. There were like five or six women in the class who were saying that that was happening to them. Never thought, you know. And then right there, I did it. Right there. Everybody laughed. You know, we all laughed. But no, and I laughed too. And I made the guy stop. I said, no, you cannot answer. You can't say, Danusha, what is it you were going to? But hey, it's all over by then. The harm has been done. And I'd already said, you're not. You are less than, and the issue is, that is the problem, trying to see this stuff, trying to make yourself aware of it, is that it's all happening behind your back. I'm here now, and all that stuff has been poured into my head, and it comes out at times when, you know, when I really work at it, I can make it visible to myself, but it's not easy to do. We're constantly fighting, we're all fighting the battle. Whether it's race or gender or sexuality or class, all of these things are keep reappearing in various ways. Was there a question associated with my lecture even now? I can't remember.
I was thinking about your reference to Rory, and I was trying to figure out what's the take-home message about the role of theory in all of this? And I was thinking about because Richard Rorty, when he says, you know, when times get tough, you know, that's when cosmopolitanism sort of falls by the wayside.
Yeah.
And it's not just the violence issue, the things that might be morally reprehensible, you might think that, you know, she really should have told where that person was, but it's the more subtle not wanting to stand up for redistribution of wealth and things like that that happen in a much, you know, much more sort of acceptable way. Like the discussion we have right now going on about distribution of wealth. And, you know, Richard Rorty, you know, he talks about we need to think about what the results are, you know, sort of pragmatist, what's the end result of the things that we're discussing. And so that's why he sort of moves away from the distancing of the theoretical language. But at the very beginning of your talk, you said, you were talking about Kokathis. And you said, you know, she says it's all about statistics, right? Think about, you know, discrimination and things like that. We need to keep track of hate crimes on the level of the statistic. And in a way, it's
individuals.
Right. I mean, she's coming from a very liberal, but I'm trying to figure out what the difference. I mean, because she says we need to think about what the result sound like. In a sense, we need to think about what the result is, not so much focus on. Right, the psychology, the psychological part of it, sort of something, and that's sort of what Gordy's thinks as well.
So let me see if I understand now. What you're asking me is that it appears as though cosmopolitanism or Rorty reduces cosmopolitanism to a kind of individualism. His argument against it is kind of.
Well, you know, Rorty, he does do that to a certain extent.
Yeah.
Because when he, you know, for him, it's all about what happens in the end. How are people affected?
Yeah.
Right? What's the result of policy? And I don't think, you know, you sort of reduce that to, you know, Kokathis's point of view. But I'm trying to figure out what, I don't know, I sort of saw a going around.
Okay.
Let me
see if this helps. The thing that bothers me about the individualist picture is that it never takes the psychology into account. Is that somehow you abstract from all of that. So your history as a woman is not involved at all. Okay. The thing that bothers me about the cosmopolitan issue is that it treats all of these identities as though they're equal, as though they come together. So my identity as a black and my identity as a man are just identities, and they're all equal. I can give up one, or I can give up. That seems problematic, and that's what I saw Rorty is saying. Rorty is arguing that 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 we have a connection to others who share an identity with us in certain ways, that we will not have to certain others in the society or in the culture or in the world. And cosmopolitanism seems to suggest that we're all just this melange, and we're all just kind of floating among these identities as though none of them, one isn't any more important than the other. Don't worry about it, you know. Yes, I may be black, but my grandmother was also Indian. And so I've got, you know, you hear people talk like that all the time. I've got Indian blood in me, and I'm also this. And I'm also, yeah, but in 1965, when I joined the Marine Corps, I may have had Indian blood in me, but my dad was more afraid that I would go to Camp Lejeune, that he, North Carolina, than he was that I would go to Vietnam. Because he said, you've never lived in the South before, and you're going to get killed. That is so, that's, you know, these, the cosmopolitan ones are treated as though there's no value. There's no value in them. I think that's the problem, and what Rorty is saying is that there is, and not only is there, the reason my dad's example comes up is that it's a moral issue. Mm-hmm. You can be injured if you don't get this right. Does that help? I don't know.
I mean, yeah. I mean, certainly, you know, on the level of cosmopolitanism, you know, same kind of criticism that Sandel gives.
Yeah.
But I'm just trying to think of when you're making policy choices, you're trying to figure out how to distribute the wealth. Like how do you, when you're trying to make policy choices, when you're thinking about affirmative action, for instance, you know, I was thinking about kind of saying, just keep track of statistics. And when it, you know, comes to, you know, cosmopolitanism is sort of, you know, it does, like you said, it's all
the same
of,
thing.
It's all kind of the same thing, right?
Here's something that's, when you say policy, you make me think of, and this pops into mind, okay, which is that let's take the idea, let's just say that these identities are important and that people are injured by them, and you're injured exactly in the way that I say. Let's just say, that John Tolkien, he's got his finger on something. He's actually right. Here's the odd thing about that. Should it be the society's problem if somehow I'm screwed up on the inside of my head because of what's happened? If you see what I'm saying here. What can society do any more than compensate me in some way? I don't know. I'm not sure I'd want to say.
Right.
Yeah, they should do more.
So then that's sort of the liberal perspective, you know. When you're making policy choices, you're not going to focus on that. You're going to try to, you know, distribute things. Mm-hmm. And, I'm just poking at it different ways.
Yeah. But the problem is that I can agree with you, and at the same time, we can know that. Let me step back, and here's what I'd want to say. I'd want to say something like this. Even though society may not be able to do something about those things, it is important that we learn how to talk about it and that we understand the cruelty and humiliation that could involve being a member of a minority group. And I mean the cruelty and humiliation in a broad sense rather than just in this narrow individualist sense, or even in the cosmopolitan. It's much bigger. And so we have a tendency then to argue about things as though it's either or. And I would suggest that it's much more complex than that. And we tend to forget that part of it.
Yeah, could we understand the debate between, say, someone like Rorty at Unitarians claim these identities and have a claim on us.
Yeah.
And the cosmopolitan is not an atheist. I mean, it seems to me that atheist is not going to deny that. And so there's a kind of, so that the debate kind of tracks. a debate about whether our theories ought to be fundamentally more explanatory or more normative. It seems to me that what Rory's saying is, yeah, but you got to realize these identities do have a claim on people. It's not just a matter of choice. And Appy is saying, well, that's true, but it should be a matter of choice. That we should aspire to that. Because, of course, in sort of contemporary America, a lot of people are really forced, because they're multiracial or multi-ethnic, they're sort of forced to choose which part of their identity they're going to emphasize, if any. And so for some people, the cosmopolitan model seems to me just exactly describes their experience. So I'm not sure that we need to choose between these two. It's a matter of whether we're talking about a context in which we need to provide an account, an explanation of how society works, or whether we're trying to provide a model for how we think it ought to work ideally. And the cosmopolitan is a kind of idea.
I don't want to suggest that we have to choose either. What I want to suggest, I tend to be more Lordy in my perspective, not Lordy in the cosmopolitan image. So I'm thinking about Lordy in the sense that Lordy I'm going to use an example in BBC, Irony and Solidarity, where he argues that our language is contingent and that what we're dealing with are metaphors, and we're not actually getting to the truth. Now, I'm not Rortian in the sense that I want to deny truth, but I am Rortian in the sense that I'm saying we need to constantly be worried about re-describing these things because of their complexity. Mm-hmm. And that's the way I'm trying to push it, so that the discussion is very important because of how complex the issues are.
Right.
That reminds me, I also teach at Southwestern College, Queen College. Oh, yeah. The demographics of communities in Southwestern and Queen are different. And I sometimes wonder what the students are thinking when they're hearing about all these cultural, how racism is this, and cultural, and human polymorphisms coming from someone that looks like me, who does not look like any of that. That, well, how can she come in here and say, this is what we're supposed to know? She doesn't know what it's like to be us.
Yeah.
So just because she's got letters behind her name.
That doesn't, you haven't lived it, so
right.
You don't know it. When I taught at UCSB, in order to make it work, what I did was I never taught race first, because I had to upset their balance in order to get them to listen. So I always taught gender first. And then I would go to race, and if I was working, and usually was with a white woman, I always suggested that she do race first rather than do gender, because it looks like special pleading if you start, so you have to be real careful about my dissertation advisor used to, because I worked with him when I first taught these courses. I had taught a couple courses here, and I think I maybe taught one or two courses at San Diego State. And I went in one day, and they hired Harry Grove, who writes on maleness, something like that. Anyway, they hired Harry Grove to teach this diversity course at UCSD. But Harry got a job at Delaware a couple of days before the course was supposed to start. So I was just a TA. I was just kind of hanging out. And they said, could you come in and do this? Well, you have to realize, there were 200 kids in those courses, and there were 6 or 7 TAs for each course that would be there. I said, I'm not doing that. I'm not going to go in there and teach race and gender and sexuality. I said, I'm going to find somebody else. And then I got home, my wife and I were talking. She said, well, how much are they paying? I didn't ask that. So I went back, and And it was about 300 more a month is all it was. There were times when I wondered if that was enough, though. But Jerry told me, don't worry, because he taught the other section. I taught one section, he's in the other section. He said, don't worry until, unless you see the glint of cold steel, then go for the door. That made me feel a little, warmed my heart. So yeah, I mean, I agree with you. It's tough. You're playing, you're working this game all the time. Yes.
I tend to respond to that sort of, you don't know what it's like. You're a rich white, person. You would know what it's like to people. I tend to confront that directly and say, you never know really who you're talking to, and you don't know what people have experienced. You're making assumptions, and then I'll cite my extreme poverty conditions during undergrad, and that usually backs them off. I've been more poor than you'll ever know. And
you remind me that we are now having on campus, because I've been doing this whole semester, a meeting of faculty in the mornings at 8:30 to discuss how to teach these issues. So faculty on our campus are getting together and having group discussions solely to talk about how to teach race in the classroom, because it's become such a problem. It's not just race, but gender and the other issues. And part of it is what you're saying. I'm sorry. The reason the connection was, is part of it is to learn how other people are doing it, so that we can expand our repertoire in terms of handling the issues.
So that all the things we're not supposed to talk about, in public at parties.
Yeah.
We're supposed to teach this.
Yeah. Exactly.
And it gets tough.
Yeah.
Because there's always going to be somebody that disagrees.
Yeah.
Sometimes I just say, okay, I'm not telling you what to believe, but on the exam, you have to put this answer. You can believe whatever you want, but don't say that, California was built by, aliens from Europe, because that's a remarkable one.
Well, Jerry, again, I'll mention Jerry, my dissertation professor, when I learned to, he taught me, I learned to teach by teaching that course. And one of the things he taught me is that, you see it in this paper, is that you never stand in one spot too long. So in essence, what I learned was to take, for example, a perspective and to push that perspective as far as you can. They don't know whether I believe it or not, but try to make them believe that I believe that whatever it is I'm saying. I am an individualist, end of story. And then to come back and to take the opposite perspective and do exactly the same thing. Because the issue is, I'm not trying to shove anything down your throat. The issue is, how do you think clearly about these things? Well, funny story that attaches to that. I ran into one of my best students after she had taken my course about a year or two later, and she talked about how much she absolutely despised the course, even though she got an A in it. She said, I would come in on Monday and you'd give this argument, and I'd think, that's it? That's the answer. And then I'd come back on Wednesday and you'd give another argument, and I'd think, oh shit, no, this is the answer. And she said, by the end of the first 2 weeks, I thought, what a wimp. I have no backbone, I don't know anything. I'm just floating around here. Whatever he says, I believe it. And that is, to some extent, I think the problem with that, there are good things about it, but the problem with it is that it leads you to relativism, which is what the students already believe anyway. And so somehow you're trying to dance around all of these issues. I want them to listen. So to do that, I'm doing a number of different perspectives, but I don't want them to be relativists. So.
You know what? You mentioned Holder, and then Eric Holder, and his comment about being cowards and not talking about these things. And you know what? I was really put off that he said that.
Oh, is that right?
Because I thought, okay, here, and I realized, of course, he's talking about all kinds of people. And he's not, and people here, they say, oh, he's talking about me, and I resent that. No, he's talking about a whole lot of people with all kinds of attitudes. But it seems to me like he was also addressing a lot of people who were in that particular teaching situation, who are trying to dance around issues because of a sensitivity, either because of a natural sensitivity or a learned sensitivity. And this is how we approach things in a roundabout way, so that we can accommodate different people's different sensitivities and yet talk about issues and yet force them to take tests. So accommodate all of that stuff. And so we are not blunt about it. And so I resent being called the R because I'm not blunt about it.
Yeah.
So I don't know. Should I see him a different way?
I hadn't thought about it in that way. There's a lot to agree with as far as that's concerned. Yeah. Because we've all got Archie Bunker in the back of our heads. That we're toying with. And we know what this looks like when you're not trying to be sensitive. I don't know enough about him to speak to that. I would
like to know what the thought process was that brought him to that state.
That little three-word or four-word thing that we're all cowards.
Maybe he's just talking about himself.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's a guy, I'm going to follow that one up, because that's an interesting aside to that.
Okay, any other questions, comments?
You know, I should say, one of the things that led me to look at this, I guess number one is the training and all of that, but that over the last year or two, first of all, I read a number of cosmopolitan texts with students as an independent study. So that's why when you got it, it didn't have cosmopolitanism in it, because I hadn't finished reading those texts yet. So, but they did an independent study, and I got to read the stuff with somebody, and we then worked on it in that way. And then with another student, I read Lorty's Solidarity, Irony, and Contingency. And I actually have kind of a pull, I've been pulled in that direction for a long time, although I'm not a postmodernist in the hard sense that there is no truth in the world. But I do understand where he's going. So that's really sort of the genesis of the paper. From Lori, I got the idea that he isn't. Not describe. And actually what Rorty says at that point is when you look historically at what happens is what we find is this constant redescription. And it isn't a matter of the redescription of the world being correct, those who redescribe it. What happens is enough people buy in to a description that those who are not buying in are kind of left out, and then that becomes the answer. And then historically, over a period of time, we come up with another way of describing it, another metaphor. And then that metaphor becomes the powerful metaphor. And everybody is. So now, for a number of years, multiculturalism has been the powerful metaphor. And I wonder if, cosmopolitanism, because we will eventually displace multiculturalism as a way of explaining that. He wants to say, though, that there is no there, that it's always going to be that. And I like to think that at least on the positive side, that a better description will lead to, or the more we talk will lead to better descriptions that will then lead to better social critiques and social policy, to get back to the policy part.
Well, you asked the question, can you have race without racism?
See, the easiest way to answer that, but it's a cop-out, it's just to say it depends on how you define it.
Okay.
But the issue is that what you notice is that racist, there isn't a place on earth
that there are races where there hasn't been harsh, cruel racism. And so the two seem to be inexorably connected together. And so that's why I say in the end that if you, that it, against the assimilationist picture, is that if you get rid of the oppression and all of the other thing, all of the other things associated with it, then it doesn't look like it's race anymore. It's something else. It's cultural identity. Okay, and that's not racism. That, those aren't racism. To go back to the question that came up earlier, that's the Irish. They get to choose. Yeah, I'm Irish, or no, I'm not Irish, or, but blacks don't get that kind of a choice, so race doesn't work in that sort of a way. So it appears as though you can't have racism without racism.
When they get to choose whether they want to be that or not, then it has moved from race to ethnicity.
Yeah, that's what Cornell and Hartman would argue, that when those groups get to choose the identity, then you're no longer a racial group, you're an ethnic group. So then that's
what, very useful. As definitions.
Yeah, it is. It does go with the genetic argument about who is the reason.
So they have like four things. The first is that
the way it distinguishes between race and ethnicity, that isn't a genetic.
Yeah, that's right. It's not a genetic.
That's very interesting.
And they say that ethnic groups normally identify in terms of notions of peoplehood or a common language, that kind of thing. Racial groups generally are seen as having physical differences. Are seen as having physical differences. But Ackerman is an exception to that. Race involves notions of power, whereas ethnicity may or may not involve notions of power. Race involves notions of worth. Ethnicity may or may not involve notions of worth. And the final one is that race, when a racial group is defined by the other as a racial group, when they start to define themselves, they are no longer racial.
So the Untouchables in India are a racial group.
Yeah, that's what they do.
And so then you think of the Mexican identity as both, in a sense.
Or in some kind of transition phase. Of course, in all groups, I mean, there are people who pass. Okay, so blacks are. I have aunts and uncles I've never met. Our name is distinctive enough that I get calls. I get calls all the time, like a couple of times a year. Now that I have a website, what I do is I refer them to the website. And in the last 10 or 15 years, I've gotten these calls. And whenever, I've had the website for a while, but not 10 or 15 years. But whenever people go to the website and actually see a picture, you never hear from them again. That's why I refer to them. It's just easier to say, well, I've got a website, look at the website. I get an email.
You still want that.
Nobody's wanted to. There's something wrong with those pictures on that website. I'm not sure what it is.
You were mentioning Argentina?
Yeah.
And the last thing you told us, although they get to choose, but I assume that the physical differences are still there.
It's still there.
You said, well, it doesn't stop the racism, where they choose to be white. Yeah. And so in other words, it doesn't seem to really matter that you choose these things, practically speaking. Uh-huh. We're stuck with the physical differences when it comes to race, more often than not. And it's like, I always thought that it's like, well, okay, so the only way to really get rid of this whole thing is that it has to just become this mulatto thing, over time. I don't know if that works either, but I don't see how choosing, and with the Japanese example, it perfect practically, if somebody finds out, even if you choose, somebody finds out, then it's terrible.
So it has to be accepted by others, right? The choice has to be accepted by others, otherwise it's more.
Yeah, yeah, it's not an individual choice, that's a social choice.
The interesting thing is how they found out about this guy, Menaka. Only a few people knew. And what happened was a reporter was standing outside of the chambers where those guys were discussing who would be the next leader. And he was up to be one of the guys. And one of the people in the chambers said, and they know these reporters are standing at the door. I mean, they know that they can overhear this stuff, is my understanding of it. What was said is, well, you don't want one of those in the presidency, do you? Mm-hmm. And it was on all papers. And he was then up there. It's the same, I mean, it's the same kind of issues that we deal with here. It's just that.
Now, had he actively avoided identification?
Yeah, until that point. Yeah. So nobody really knew until it came out in the chambers at that time. The Argentina thing, though, one of the things that I didn't put in the paper that a friend of mine who spends a lot of time in Latin America, we were talking about, he said that it isn't simply the race issue in terms of the blacks declaring who they are. We also have to forget, or we also have to remember that in Latin America there's a forgetting thing that's going on too. That people are forgetting how these groups were formed. And so that is a part of all of this stuff that we see. I was in Cuba a couple years ago. That was an experience, because a large part of the Cuban population is black, or Afro-Cubans. The white Cubans deny that there's any racism on that island, any differences recognized at all, and they're vehement about it. And a guy was giving a paper about race in Cuba, and there were a number of ladies in the argument, or in the audience, older ladies, who literally stood up stomped out. First they said, there is no race in Cuba. And they left. Now, that would have worked, because this was my first trip to Cuba, until I started to notice that the only people who worked in the hotels where Europeans and Americans stayed and gave tips and where they made a lot of money were the white Cubans. Black Cubans didn't work in hotels. They weren't even seen in that downtown area, kids going to school and that kind of stuff. So, yeah, you get your antennae up, you get sensitive to this stuff, and you kind of wonder. You see it everywhere. Even though Castro has really tried very hard to get rid of that, but it still reoccurs. And notice what it does, to get back to your question, it reoccurs in a class way, because the white Cubans then have access to things that the black Cubans don't have. So it recreates this difference in money difference in the system. And all of the Cubans who left Cuba were the white Cubans. Those are the ones that are living in Miami because they had the money. They were the doctors and lawyers and attorneys, and so they're the ones who have a stake in making sure that when they get back there, property back. They lost. You've got these battles still occurring in a class way.
We've got about 1 minute before somebody comes to the door.
Really?
I don't know.
Well, let me take a minute. Thank you. It's really fun. I enjoyed it.
Thank you.
Thanks for the time.